In any event, where to begin with my life? Well, I was born, that's for sure. And I was born a male, that's certainly for sure. The rest of it's all crapshoots.
What did I say? Think about it after eight decades.
Eight decades on the planet. And I'm saying, where am I? I am not on planet Earth. It's a different world out there. Better or worse, I know not. All I know is that I confront it every day of my life when I work with seniors who have myriad health problems, which we haven't corrected. And we're worried about people going to Mars. We're worried about some plane crash that took place in a godforsaken part of the ocean. What is going on in this culture about priorities? And it's very destructive. On the other hand, I become guardedly optimistic when I talk about education. Somewhere in the gene pool, I got the bug about ideas and about examining the nature of ideas. And that has stuck with me right up to the present. I was always a curiosity person from the day one, and did a lot of things that were, what they said, were unorthodox for a five-year-old to take a five-mile trip on a tricycle in Bronx, New York, when it was all farms. And didn't tell my parents, obviously, but then they found out I got royally taken care of. I was born in a kind of family where the culture plays a big part. And I'll state categorically right now that almost all of our behaviors are determined by social constructionism. What I mean by that is that, as Ricky had alluded to, this is not a biological phenomenon unless we want to make it a biological phenomenon. And I have some things to say about that as well. But basically, all of the attitudes, all of the proclivities, all of the destructiveness comes from interactions with a culture, whatever culture that is. I happen to be born in white, not Anglo-Saxon, American intergenderational cultural phenomena. And when I was born, I was the firstborn in my family. And the tradition in the Eastern Mediterranean is that the firstborn male in a family gets all the cubes of sugar from everybody, whether they had children from other relationships or not. So for the first 5 years, I lived with my grandparents. I had four aunts, two uncles, and a myriad of cousins, all in the same neighborhood. This was really high family density, if you will. Half of them came from the old country. The other half were trying to make it in the new country. And then I come into the scene, totally wet behind the ears, they told me. And I was the prince. Now, I don't know if it gets across to many of you who have not had that experience, but for me, as I look back on it, I really cherish that period. It was the most formative period of my life, I could say, after eight decades. Everything else that followed from that would be derivative of that first 3 years on the planet. And I've had a chance to explore this in various ways over the next 7 decades. I did many different activities, but one thing that remained clear for me, I need to stay educated. I need to learn. The more I learned, the more I was able to teach. The more I was able to teach, the more I was able to learn what I didn't know and move further. I had some help with that from the school system that I went to in New York City. And I apparently was a very gifted student, both in music and mathematics and other mundane areas. But it wasn't until well after college that I came out of the closet as a cross-dresser. I've been a cross-dresser since maybe the 10th year of my life. Most of it done sub rosa, wearing mother's clothes, and not the typical kind of thing I want to be like mommy. I really explored the full gamut as much as I could, trying not to get caught. And if time permits, I'll tell you that saga. I did get caught. I did go to my family physician. I also told myself that I won't do this again, because if I do, I'll be in a mental hospital. And in those days, they weren't called mental hospitals, they were called asylums. And New York was notorious for having asylums that were totally, I would say Neanderthal, but that's a good word for the New York asylum system. Fortunately, they're all gone now, but I did have a chance to visit one in the second decade of my life. I was appalled. And I didn't know anything about mental hospitals except from a film called The Snake Pit. Does anybody remember seeing The Snake Pit? That was it, let me tell you. So I said, they're not going to catch me doing this. So I was really very sub-rosa about it. And it wasn't until maybe 25 years later that I finally came out of the closet and with full gusto, using some of my other talents. Well, that's a little bit of the background of things. I still maintain that the first decade of the life of an infant is the most important. And apart from the health issues of having to learn how to go to the bathroom, how to eat food, how to breathe, how to burp, and how to walk, all of this takes place within the first year and a half to 2 years from normal children that we know of. But there are no tests talking about hormones at this age. And the hormones that we should be talking about are growth hormones, the things that we know in the endocrine system that nobody pays attention to. Hence, there's a real area of really good research to be done about how these hormones interact in the early childhood development of a child, male or female. The blue blanket, red, pink blanket, is that what? Pink blanket? Yeah. Blue blanket, pink blanket syndrome was created in the 1890s. I think a New York Times or the Herald Tribune put something about how you distinguish between babies in a carriage. So if they're wearing blue bonnets, they were males. If they're wearing pink bonnets, they were females, and that was immutable. The second, more insidious thing is the state's use of gender as the way to identify you. And we see that every time a trans person wants to get the name change. Why are you doing this? How are you doing this? Are you in debt? Have you murdered somebody? And try to get a passport from these guys today, it's like, hello? So, and I don't know if it's like in Canada, but in the United States, it's become almost fascistic. Run by people who are less than what I call sane. And fortunately, when I finally had to get my name modified, and I didn't do it legally, I did it by dint of recommendation. I was recommended to the the passport authority. But I should have two names on my passport, because I was doing programs in Canada and abroad. And in abroad, as abroad, was very interesting. the long and the short of this thing was, there are some legal hurdles we all have to go through, which create the anxiety of being human. I think most of our culture is based on an anxiety format here. And when you don't get it, you say, well, what am I worried about? It's when you start saying, oh my God, how am I going to get across the inspection here. I have two breast forms, two sets of breast forms, one of which were the ones that women use when they have mastectomies. The other was a makeshift one that I had done in my work in biochemistry. We created some plastic gels, and we had forms. And this friend of mine, wonderful, wonderful friend, who actually brought me out of the closet in the 70s, and I worked on these. And we announced them at Fantasia Fair, when Fantasia Fair was running, that we had the best breast forms because they could be attached to your body without any interventions, and you could swim with them, and you could have cleavage, and on and on and on. And of course, this culture is big on how your breasts are formed, how close they are to each other to form this V, how to entice, how to suppress, you name it, they can do it, and women do do it. I've learned a little bit of the technique, but I'm not enamored of having them permanently. I think of the friends that I've had who've had these things, you know, female friends, and it's not a good sign. They really rue the day that they're so big. They rue the day that they don't function anymore. And they rue the day that if they had to do any modification, it would have been a mastectomy because of cancer. And yet we continue to labor that the breast is one of the most erotic parts of the body. So all of the cross-dressing population has got to have something that reflects that. And so that's one of the props. And there are a whole series of props. So that I began to see in the teenage years that you've got to have a certain set of props to cross the line from being a teenage girl to being a young woman, to being a hunk, that's not the word. What's the word? One of my problems now as I get older is I have the word on the tip of my tongue and I can't say it. Not because I don't want to say it, it just slips out. Talk about neuron tragedy. Anyway, well hung is the right word. And I was very shy about being well hung. I said to myself, I'm not going in a bathing suit that has really real pocket, or what we call it, a basket. I learned from my gay friends how they deal with it. I was cut, not uncut. Now, if you're in the parlance of the gay world today, you got to talk about being cut or uncut. Now, I didn't have surgery, but I was cut. I was cut.
So,
all this by way of saying that lots of the craziness of growing up and being, I didn't call myself a transgender, I was called TV 5 minutes. Oh, please. I'm actually going to fight. Oh, I missed the kernels. I missed the kernels of my talk. Unlike Ricky, her testimony here, like it was a 12-page line. Let me just cut to the chase. Let me chase that. Don't bring this up. Sometimes when I'm just in the stream of consciousness teaching, it just comes out like, I'm sorry. I wrote almost on a plane, and then I looked at it, 8 pages. I mean, just like Susan did. She saw that biography, all the things that she didn't do that were not included. I did it in spades, but what I want to make sure I cover you guys with has to do with why I think the world can be better if you educate them, not leave them in the lurch. And that's why particularly education in the preschool area is critical to changing how we feel about gender, how we feel about sexuality, how we feel about not going to war. It all happens in the first 5 years of the first decade. If you're a war hawk or you're a dove or whatever, you don't see that until you're a teenager, and maybe even later, if you are unlucky or lucky, as the case may be. Achievements. I'm not going to talk about them. They're all in my book. Where's that little thing I have? Here. Book was done by Vern Boyle, well-known friend, sexologist, sex therapist, writer, you name it, Vern and his lovely wife, Connie. Was it Connie?
Bonnie.
Were instrumental in putting the trans world into the professional arena from the point of view of behavior as opposed to psychology, psychiatry, and diagnosis that are totally erroneous in DSM 4, 5, 6, and even 3. But I'm always appalled when it comes to raising the gender questions, they've got all the answers. But when they took out homosexuality from the DSM, nobody batted an eyelash. You know why? Half of those guys, not gals, were gay. So how could you be gay and be on a panel when you're diagnosed as mentally defective? Anyway, that changed, but it hasn't changed for transgender. What's more, there were people who really were uncomfortable with gender shift. I want to be a woman today. What's wrong with that? So what were women wearing in those days? If you were 15, it was a skirt, you were wearing tops. Pants were not in the wardrobe, except once in a while when you went on a picnic. Then you could wear a set of slacks. Otherwise, you didn't wear a skirt. They would never know who you were. And in the court system in the United States, women attorneys could not come in pantsuits. It was only about 10 years ago that finally allowed that to happen. And I said to myself, what's that all about? And it turns out the judges, who were mostly males, did not want to see women attorneys dressed like paper. So they didn't allow that. And then they said, there's a protocol. And that's the one thing about democracies that you have to be careful of. Whenever they run into a roadblock, there's two strategies. One, regulation. If we regulate it, then we can control it. That's number one. Number two, if we can't control it, we become fiat and almost oligarchic in our thinking about how we deal with things we don't like. And if we are in power, we make sure it doesn't get done. And we see this around the states in the United States. The southern states, we've had some very good discussion about how people look at gender and so forth. So a lot of this is in the book. I have my own autobiography in here, worth a read if you've got 10 minutes. But there's some other ones that are really worth looking at. And there are 20 of them, all written by the people themselves. And Vern and I did the cover things, like introductions, and I did the glossaries and things at the end. In fact, Dallas is one of the participants in that. I had a different idea about the cover of this book. That's what you see up here. I looked at the yin-yang symbol. I was really very much into the Jungian concepts of how gender, anima, all those things. Does anybody study those anymore? I mean, you know, it's like passing words. But Jung and the Buddhist mentality, and particularly the karma of the Indian sexuality credo, all played a part in the understanding of what I looked at as my gender performance. And there were other professionals, which we don't talk about anymore, that I think deserve mention, so I want to include them in this particular talk. One is a guy named Robert Stoller. Now, Robert Stoller was a psychiatrist, and he was at UCLA, and he worked with Virginia Prince in trying to unfurl the mystery of why she cross-dressed and why he wanted to find out why other people are cross-dressed. Well, he wrote some very good books, and they were well-written, about presentations of gender. And I recommend that as one of the real important pillars of how social development takes place in this country and most of the countries of the world, East or West, makes no difference. The other person that I want to be sure that we don't forget, and I could be remiss about this, but John Money was, at the time my star was rising, his star had already risen. He was basically a biology teacher, and his domicile of operations was Johns Hopkins University. I'll mention Johns Hopkins a little bit later for half a minute. But John was working in the field of endocrinology and working with monkeys. And he discovered some things about monkey behavior that could be considered part of the behavior mechanism for people who were transsexual. At that time, it was a very clear designation. I want to change my sex, not my gender. But everybody confused sex and gender. So when you said, I've changed my sex, it means I'm automatically going to change my gender. And John picked up on that. He was a wordsmith. He was incredibly clever. And he was pretty clear, and he lectured all over the world about his concept of what it's like to be transgender. He didn't even use the term, he wouldn't use a term like transgender. You were sexually dysphoric or mentally whatever. And I had a real run-in with him when he came to Harvard in Boston. And I told him, you have the audacity to come to our group. And he didn't come to the cross-dresser group, but he came to a group of professional people who were at Harvard listening to pearls of wisdom about gender. And he said, our studies with monkeys and simians of a certain type indicate that. So we now can, by extrapolation, say that human behavior forms sort of like that, particularly with regard to gender. Because how do monkeys distinguish between males and females? They have to smell them, right? So there's this whole attitude that animal behaviors are bellwethers for how human behavior. Of course, we're not animals, we're real humans. So I went on a big kick about that. And then 3 years later, we met at one of the ASEC or Quad S meetings. Those are alphabets of healthcare professionals who don't want to be seen in the circles thinking about trans or whatever. And I met John, and we talked again. He was not quite as vociferous, but he had written 50 books, so you couldn't touch him with a 10-foot pole. Yes, here comes, I think, the kicker or the punchline. I was invited to come to the 5th International World Congress of Sexology and present my views about gender in North America. Because in South America, things are very different than they are in North America. And so I said, how am I going to do this? And so I packed a careful suitcase, just like I did to get here, what things they might want to see if they opened up my small suitcase, which was filled to the gills, packed it hoping that they would not do anything when I went through customs in Caracas. Turns out that in Caracas, it's easy to bypass the dogana, that's the customs, when you work for the university. And this guy who had set up this conference made sure the dogana didn't inspect anybody who was coming on behalf of the conference. So I was lucky that way. And John Money helped engineer this conference. I didn't know that. If it had, I probably might have had a different turn of thoughts. But some other people invited me to come. And I said, here's a real opportunity. Not only can I be in countries that never come to North America to see this stuff, the people who should come don't come, but I had a chance to learn something about how they deal with gender diversity. And gender diversity is taught much differently in the Latin American countries, including Portugal, which is a Latin American country, than the... finish this last comment. I'll be able to get on the question and answer when it happens. Anyway, the night of the great cocktail party, there were many students at this thing, and they knew about me as a gender specialist, but they didn't expect to meet Ariadne. So I said to one of my colleagues, I said, would you mind if I came as Ariadne tonight? And I brought one of those dresses that you can flop all around and you put on and unwrinkle, you know, a little bit of jewelry. We actually went to one of the markets to buy some Venezuelan earrings, and just as a token of enmity and cross-cultural feeling good. I get down there, and John Money comes right up to me and says, young lady, I would like to escort you into the festivities. I fell off my, I would say rocker, but I was just overwhelmed. And he was terribly gentlemanly. So here is our guy who I had nothing but anger for. His work was impeccable. As an academic, I had no regrets about reading him. But here he came out in his social role. Go to find out, 10 years later, he was a gay man. So he had more than just academic interest about the trans world. And if someone will ask me another story about Johns Hopkins, which is important, I will share another part of that with you. Thank you so much for listening to me.